after starting the franchise on this channel with Final Fantasy IV, I always knew that I wanted the next game I covered to be one of the franchise's many spin-offs. But the question was, which one? In the end, I settled for Final Fantasy Adventure, as it also allows me to get a start on the Mana series. I used to see some confusion over that, with people declaring this game not a Final Fantasy. I don't know how much of that confusion is still around, but I may as well clear it up. People will say that the game's Japanese name is Seiken Densetsu, as in the first of the Mana series, with Secret of Mana being Seiken Densetsu 2 and so on. But the full Japanese name is Seiken Densetsu Final Fantasy Gaiden. Then the sequels would drop Final Fantasy from the name and become their own series, as would any remakes this game would have. So this game is both a Final Fantasy spin-off and the first game in a completely different series, so this is the only Mana game I also count as a Final Fantasy game. This isn't a Final Fantasy Legends situation where the games actually had nothing to do with Final Fantasy. Of course, over here in the PAL territories, we didn't get the first six Final Fantasy games at first, so this was just called Mystic Quest, with Final Fantasy Mystic Quest becoming just Mystic Quest Legend, with Final Fantasy dropped from the name. But we did get Final Fantasy Legends somehow, with that name. But the Mana series is one I don't have that much experience with. I'd played a few seconds of Secret of Mana back as a kid when our first Xbox had SNES 9X on it, but then at the start of 2020 I gave it a full playthrough on the Collection of Mana, which is also what I'm using for this game. But before that, I do also own Children of Mana on the DS, which I got for Christmas 2007, but I never got very far on it. And then this playthrough here is my first time playing this game. It's going to be nice to play an RPG with a much simpler 100% requirement for me after Final Fantasy IV, Guardians Crusade and Pokémon. Simply collect all the treasure and fully level my one character while playing the game normally. So let's get into it. Starting a new game gives you a quick explanation of what's going on. The source of the world's mana, the Mana Tree, grows above the clouds at the top of Mount Illusia, and is said to grant infinite power to any who touch it. And there's this Dark Lord called Dark Lord who's after it so he can use that power to conquer the world. I have to name the main character, and based on what I've looked up, his canon name is Sumo, so that's what I'll be going with. I also have to name the female lead, who looks to be called Fuji. Once I'm done naming, we start with Sumo entering a gladiator arena to fight the first boss, the Jackal. The only attack I have right now is my sword, which I stab forward like in the first Zelda, and also swing like the later 2D games. But the longer I go without attacking, the more this bar along the bottom fills, allowing me to do a stronger attack that then empties the bar again. Just a few good hits takes it down. We're told that Sumo is a fighter for the Empire of Glaive, and he and his friends are forced to fight every day for the Dark Lord's entertainment. Many of them have died as a result of the fights, which leads to Sumo standing over his dying friend, Willy. He tells Sumo that the world's mana is in danger and to go find the Gemma Knights and warn them. Willy tells him to find one of them called Bogard at the falls, saying he should know what to do. Sumo has no idea what he's talking about, but Willy dies before he can explain further. Whacking him with the sword doesn't help either. I leave the room where I can talk to other friends. There's Amanda, who says they need to escape as she wants to go home and see her brother. Then this other guy who doesn't even have a name, so who cares. He does at least let me know that the way outside is through the entrance veil that the monster's in, though. So I go east and up the stairs, leading back into the arena, where I have to fight a second jackal. I take it out the same way and run through the door, but I'm next seen climbing down the castle wall. I travel to the west to find a waterfall, but stand back and watch as the Dark Lord and his right hand, Julius, are there. Listening in, we learn that the mana tree is above that waterfall in a shrine. The only way to reach the tree is up the falls, and the only way up them is to find the girl with the power to reverse the falls. The Dark Lord then sends Julius to find her. Julius teleports out, putting Sumo in the Dark Lord's line of sight. He gives chase and Sumo runs off, finding his back to the top of another waterfall. The Dark Lord rugby tackles Sumo off the cliff, and he falls all the way down the waterfall, passing out and waking up with no idea where he is. He gets over it quick though, and I can get going. East takes me to a screen with some enemies, goblins and mushbooms. Mushbooms are no threat, while the goblins can at least throw swords. I go east again, and the goblin I kill here drops a chest with some candy, a healing item. I then go south, and on the next screen, I go east again. I go through the fence to the north to reach the town Topple. This place isn't very important, but it does give me my first chance to heal at an inn and buy items and equipment. I check my equipment and see I'm starting with a broadsword and a full set of bronze armour. I leave the town and go south to another screen, and then east to the next. There's a woman next to an injured man shouting for help. I take out the single mushboom menacing them. The girl says that the guy, Haseem, is seriously wounded. I talk to Haseem and he tells me to take the girl to Wendell to see Bogar, who will take care of her. Haseem then dies. I'm only 10 minutes into the game and I've already seen two named NPCs die. Sumo says he's looking for Bogar too and asks her to come with him. She introduces herself as Fuji and joins me. Now Fuji will travel alongside me. Talking to her through the menu will have her slightly heal me, which will be very useful because I want to make some money for some equipment in Topple. And having Fuji healing me for free will save me money that would be spent on an inn. So I run between screens killing enemies for money. Money is automatically added to your GP total on killing each enemy. They also reach level 2. On each level up, I'm given a stat I can add extra points to. I want to try and get each stat as high as possible. I start by choosing power, which adds 2 to my power stat, 1 each to stamina and will, but nothing to wisdom. Each one is like this, 2 to the one you choose, 1 each to 2 others, and nothing to a 4th one. 3 minutes into this little grind, I also reach level 3, choosing wisdom. That's 2 to wisdom, 1 to stamina and will, and nothing to power, putting all stats at a nice even 4. 5 minutes later and I reach level 4. I choose power again. It seems alternating between power and wisdom is all I need, as it keeps them all balanced, so I won't point out what I choose anymore. All even numbered levels are power, and all odd numbered levels are wisdom. Once I have enough, I buy myself a 140 GP iron helmet in Topple. It's only 1 point stronger, but it's still an upgrade. I also buy myself a pack of 4 keys for later. Time to get moving. From the screen outside of Topple, I go east, east again, south, east once again, north, and then west back to this screen where I can cross the bridge across the river and go north. New enemy on this screen, the iconic Rabbite making its first appearance, along with my first chibi devils, but I can't reach most of them, so I go west and west again to find some I can reach. They only deal 4 damage on contact, but this early on, that's still a big amount. I ignore the vine here and go west and then north to climb the 2 vines here north to the next screen. I climb around the 2 vines north and 2 vines south back to the previous screen, then west to another, and north up another vine so I can enter the house next to this waterfall. I talk to the old man inside, and Sumo tells him he's looking for Bogard, but he ignores him. Talk to him again and he says he doesn't know anything. Then one more time before he notices Fuji's pendant, the Pendant of Mana, which Fuji says was given to her by her mother. He admits to being Bogard, once a Gemma Knight back when another empire, Vandal, was trying to use mana to conquer the world. The knights fought against them, but mana was too powerful. One woman managed to get them to victory, one who had the same pendant. He recognises Fuji as the key for the current time. He tells me to take the mattock from the next room, go to the cave east of here and use the mattock to break my way through and find Kibba in the town Wendell. He opens a door into the back room and I take the mattock from the chest. I gain 7 actually, since these are a one-use item, and they're gonna cause me a bit of trouble. So to start with, I backtrack across a few screens, and once I reach the east end of the screen with 2 vines on that side, I take the eastern exit to the next screen between them. I go east across 2 more vines to reach the screen containing the cave entrance. I can see rocks blocking the way forward and equip the mattock as an item. One swing is all you get from them, so make sure you hit what you're aiming for. I go south through the entrance I opened, cross a bridge and go south again to reach a room with some stairs. They lead me back outside, and on the opposite side of the river on a screen I've passed through before. I go east, cross the bridge and reach level 5. There's a lot of pauses on the recordings on these stat screens because I was individually writing down every level and the choice I made to make absolutely sure I didn't mess it up. Just whole pages of a notebook saying, power, wisdom, power, wisdom. I keep going east, south, east and into the house here. The man inside is selling a battle axe for 150 GP, but I'm 20 short. So I do a bit of killing across the last few screens to speed it up. I buy it and it's 4 points stronger than the broadsword. Axes are just better to use than swords anyway since every attack is a swinging motion, which means I'm covering more space when fighting. I go east another screen to enter the marshes. 2 new enemies on this screen, the jellyfish Grell and the Deathflower. Nice to see enemies granting a whole 4 GP. I go south and south again on the next screen. Here is where I face my first swamp man, completely immune to my axe, so I just go west. I run right into a Grell and get poisoned. Poison only lasts a few seconds, so I just have Fuji heal me to outpace it until it wears off. I go west again and on the next screen cross a bridge and west again, taking me to this large building. This is a hotel, Ketz. The man in the first room says that most rooms are taken, but I'm free to use the western rooms. He also says I'm not allowed through the door behind him, as it's for a Mr. Lee. There's a couple people in a room to the north, one of which tells me of a mystic mirror that the owner of this place threw away in a cave, and a white mage who says there's a lizard man nest to the south. She says they have the key to open the cave of Marsh. I go to the west to the other room, and despite the not very welcoming music in this place, I go to sleep. Through the night, Fuji tells Sumo she thinks he should be able to use cure magic and gives him the magic book that teaches it, just in time for her to disappear during the night so she can't heal me herself. And don't think I ever noticed that Sumo keeps his shield on his arm even in bed. I ask the guy in the first room, but he claims to not know anything. Can't do anything else, and so I leave and backtrack east 3 screens and then go south to find that lizard man nest that was mentioned. The first one I kill then brings me up to level 6. These guys move slowly, and they liked to not aim their arrows at me, so it takes little effort to kill them. Taking them all out spawns a chest in the middle containing a bronze key. I then go back north and east to a new screen where I learn that swamp men are incredibly strong at this point in the game, as one being near when I enter the screen has me almost dead. But cure is pretty good right now, just 2 MP and my max HP is low enough that I get a full heal. I go north again and use the bronze key to open the door to the Cave of Marsh. Inside is a guy dressed just like a red mage. I talk to him and he says that many girls have gone missing in Kets. He thinks they'll be being kept in the caskets in the basement. He also asks me if I need help looking for the Mystic Mirror. Of course I have him join. I go north to meet my first roper and landleech. The nameless man is quite helpful, sending out streams of big fireballs. I go west into the next screen, take out the enemies and step on this switch to open up some stairs in the corner. It takes me outside where I cross this log east, climb down the vine at the end and go back west to find a way back inside. Nothing in this room and so I go east to the next. I use a mattock in the middle south between these rocks to break down the wall and open up a new room. I slide over the ice to reach a chest containing a sickle. It's 1 point stronger than the battle axe, but more important is that sickles can cut down these plants blocking my exit. They're also swung in a full circle and faster than axes, which is nice. I backtrack all the way to the start and take the southern route instead. Inside is a green slime but is immune to my sickle, so I need the man to kill it. On the western wall between the grass, I use another mattock to break down another wall. This screen has my first skeleton enemies who are far less a threat than the slimes. Killing all enemies in here gets me to level 7. There's a locked door to the north and I use one of my keys on it. Inside is an empty chest and a switch that goes back up as soon as I step off it. So I push the chest onto it and go down the stairs in the corner. Inside are two plants my sickle can't reach in the middle of some water. So I backtrack two rooms and go west, then west again. Nothing much and I go north to find a room filled with plants to cut. One of them drops a chest with another 4 keys inside, which is helpful. I use one to go through the locked door to the east. I take out all the enemies to spawn a chest containing an iron shield. I go back and cut through the plants to go north and then east again. I use a mattock to destroy the rock in the corner to reveal some stairs to a wall covered in vines. I climb down to the bottom and cross a bridge going west to a door back inside. I unlock the only door in this room and go west, then south, then unlock the door going east. Killing the enemies in this room gets me to level 8. I use two mattocks on the top and bottom rock so that I can stand on the switches to open more stairs. Down those stairs, I go east one more time to reach a boss, the Hydra. It moves around the water spitting fireballs from both heads. I have to wait for it to get close enough to me so that I can whack it in the head with the sickle. It's pretty easy and I just wait for it to take enough hits to die. It leaves behind a bridge and two chests. The first one contains the Magic Book of Fire. The second has the mirror. The man tells me to show the mirror to the guy at Kets. He then leaves and I'm walked to the door to the cave. The fire spell is a homing attack and it's one of the ways to kill swamp men. I return to Kets and take the chance to have a snooze since Fuji isn't here to heal me for free. I go up to the man and show him the mirror. It reveals his true form, a werewolf. He just wanders around for a bit and 4 hits takes him out, opening the door to the east. New enemies in this room, the pumpkin and the blood owl. I unlock the door going east and since the man abandoned me, I can't kill the slimes for free anymore. I just ignore them and unlock the door going north. Another two enemies, zombie and were-rat. The zombies are immune to my weapons so I have to use fire on them. I unlock the door going west and in the next room go up the stairs. I go south through the door and use my last mattock to break open the eastern wall. I then go north and east, around the blocks and south. In this room I reach level 9 and go south again, then west. But there's a problem. I didn't need to use a second mattock in that one room in the Cave of Marsh and now I've run out. And you can't buy any more yet. I have no choice but to either restart the game or just keep killing enemies until one of them drops a chest, which has a rare chance of having a mattock inside. This is the only complaint I have with the early game of Final Fantasy Adventure, which, without saying much, I found more enjoyable than the early game of Secret of Mana. I just don't think you should have to do something perfectly or be trapped grinding out rare drops for a while. I mean, I was using a guide to make sure I found every treasure. Someone working it out for themselves would be fucked. I reach level 10 during this search and while I still don't have a mattock, the enemy drops have me loaded upon keys. 10 minutes it takes for a skeleton back near the start to drop a set. Back to that room I smash a vase to reach the switch to open some stairs going down. In this room I go east, then north and unlock another door going north. It takes me to a chest containing a chain. The chain is 1 point stronger than the sickle, but only attacks in a straight line. I need to use it to latch onto this post and drag myself over the blocks that have trapped me inside. I then press the switch so I can leave. I return to the vase room and go up the other set of stairs. It has me outside and high up. I go west and use the chain to cross a gap. West again and down some stairs to end up back inside. I go west, north and reach level 11. I then try to chain across this pit but fall in. In this new room I go north, up the stairs and south to reach the other side of the pit anyway. I go east, east again and north, then west to reach another room where I have to push a chest onto a switch to create some stairs to go down. In this room I use a mattock on the bottom right vase to find more stairs going down. From here I go east, then unlock a door going south to find a room full of caskets. I find Fuji in one of them and she gets following me again. She's unharmed, but more importantly, I have my free healer back. I now have to make my way back to the start. It's a long trek and nothing interesting happens until I make it back to the entrance. The before mentioned Mr. Lee isn't happy with me taking one of his victims and reveals himself to be a vampire, the next boss. He swoops around the screen releasing bats, but most of them are killed by my chain as I'm hitting him. It doesn't take very long to kill him and I receive the magic book of sleep for it. We leave the place and Fuji says that Wendell is to the south. So I go the 3 screens east and 1 south to return to the Lizardman nest. Then it's west to a screen covered in plants, so I have to re-equip my sickle to cut through and go south. I go west and then north, and on the next screen chain across the river, and on this side go back south and east, then south for another new enemy. The orcs on this screen get me to level 12. I go south again and fight my first killer bees. These are another one that can poison on contact, so the chain is a good weapon to fighting them from a distance. I go east and on the next screen there's a bridge going north leading to the town Wendell, known as the Sacred Town. The man who helped me out in the Cave of Marsh is in the southeast corner of town, still not telling me his name. In the middle of town I can learn the reason this town is doing so well. The rivers that flow through this town and support its nature flow from the waterfalls flowing from the Tree of Mana itself. One kid tells me there's a dwarf cave to the west and with all the money I've built up I can upgrade my equipment. An iron shield and some iron armour combined for a 5-point increase to my defence. I enter the temple in the middle of town to meet the sage Kibba. He already knows about us from Bogard. He confirms Fuji's pendant carries a symbol of mana and has her step into the magic circle. She does so and calls forth the spirit of her mother. Kibba says that she was the one who encouraged the Gemma Knights in the past. She tells Fuji that they are from the Mana family, the seeds of the Mana tree. The Vandal Empire abused the tree's power years ago and so she sealed off the waterfalls with the pendant, preventing any others from reaching it. But now they have a new empire going after the Mana tree with Glaive. She tells Fuji to guard the tree with the Gemma Knights and then disappears. Explosions can be heard and the man comes in saying that Glaive is attacking the town. He offers to take Fuji to a safe place and leaves with her. And he's never even there before, what a kind man. Seconds later, Kibba asks where this safe place actually is, so Sumo goes check. Turns out the man is actually a bit dodgy as he attacked the town greeter from behind on his way out, mortally wounding him. The town is filled with monsters but it's all weak early game stuff so it's easy. Then I make my way to the bridge leading into town. The man is waiting and he sheds his disguise to reveal that he was Julius all along. He only helped Sumo because he needed to be sure that Fuji was the girl they're looking for, and watching the conversation with her mother confirmed it. But Glaive have her now, and when Sumo tries to save her, Julius knocks him out and leaves him there. Sumo wakes up back in the temple with Kibba. When Sumo wakes up, Kibba tells him that Julius has taken Fuji to the west on his airship. Before Sumo takes off after her, Kibba gives him the magic book of heal, the spell that cures status ailments. I don't buy any yet, but I should mention that you can buy mattocks in Wendell, meaning I no longer have to grind enemy drops if I run out. From Wendell, I go west, then south and west again. The beach it takes me to has my first encounter with death crabs who can throw their claws at me. I have to equip my axe here so I can cut down the trees and move north and then west. I go west again where killing a pair of orcs gets me to level 13. From here it's south and into the cave entrance. In this first room is a dwarf, just a straight up classic Final Fantasy dwarf sprite. Going south and west through the rooms takes me to a dwarf who tells me about one called Watts, who loves the mines and is currently there. Wrong there, by the way. One says that if I go to the mines and want to use the trolley there, I have to get oil, which can be bought from a shop to the south. The last one has seen Julius's airship, saying that I need to go through the Gaia Pass to reach the western lands. From the cave, I go back north and chain across the river to go south again. South again and east to find a hut. This is the shop the dwarf mentioned and I buy the oil for 500 GP. From the ship, I go north, chain across the river and north again to a screen I've already visited, then north again, cut down some trees and north again. On this screen I have to cut my way through the right path, as many trees here will leave tiny stumps that Sumo can't be asked to try climbing over. When I make it through, I go west to a screen with the entrance to the silver mine. First screen just has the trolley and I use the oil to get it moving. I ride through the next room, taking out my first tarantula, miss both switches as I ride through the rooms and end up going in a circle. Also, it's total bullshit that me driving a minecart into a spider at high speeds ends not with the spider being obliterated, but with me being poisoned. The chain is clearly not useful enough, and so I use the sickle's range to hit the first switch and send me south. That just shortens the loop and doesn't help me. On another of my cycles, I reach level 14. Instead, I loop around to the second switch and hit that one to send me south. But then I miss a third switch and end up back in the loop. Next time I'm ready for it, and I hit it to send the trolley west, where it crashes into a rock and sends me flying down a pit. After waking up, I find that Watts is there. He decides to tag along and help me out. Talking to Watts through the menu allows me to buy a few items from him, and make sure to get some mattocks while he's here. North into the next room introduces another two new enemies, the Mimic and the Ruster. Watts fights by throwing an unlimited supply of axes around. I break through the rock at the top with the mattock and go east, then break through another rock and go south. This room contains a full recovery spring, so it's back north and breaking down the eastern wall. In this next room I smash a vase, stand on the switch it leads me to, and then slide along the ice to the stairs it creates. It leads outside where I go west, cross a bridge, and keep moving west, and then back into the cave. In here it's west and then north and up the stairs in the corner. Through the door to the west and then down a set of stairs to end up back outside again. I climb down the vine to reach the boss of this place, the Megapede. It comes out of one of the four holes in this arena and moves about, with only its head taking damage. The length of the chain is helpful here, being able to hit the head through any invincible body segments blocking the way. While Watts is invincible, his aim isn't that great and he rarely gets any hits in. It takes quite a few hits, but it eventually explodes and leaves behind a chest containing silver. We walk to the entrance and Watts says he'll take the silver and forge armor and weapons out of it, saying Gaia will let me pass if I wear silver. He sets off ahead, leaving me to backtrack to the dwarf cave alone. It doesn't take long. I talk to Watts, who says I can have the silver equipment, but then charges me for it. Good thing I can afford everything. Silver armor, a silver shield, and a silver sword. Free extra defense, and the silver sword is 4 points stronger than the chain. From the cave, I go north, and the first enemy I kill gets me to level 15. I needed that too for the full heal you get on level up, since my MP was almost gone. I go north again, west and north to reach another cave. This is the Gaia Pass. I go west here and get to show off a fully charged sword attack, making me zoom back and forth around the screen. I go south and try to go south again, but a door slams shut when I get close. I just have to step back onto the tile that shut it to open it again. It then leads me to some stairs that put me back on the overworld. Before I can move on, Bogard catches up with me. He's been filled in on the situation by Kibber and says there's still time to save Fuji as the airship is refueling at a lake to the north. And so he joins up with me and we go south. Werewolves are now a regular enemy and Bogard fights with simple sword stabs. Bit underwhelming compared to the company I've had before him. I move south and west, meeting the first Sahagin in the game, throwing tridents from the water. I go north again and east, which puts me in an enclosed space with the wolves from a few screens back. Thanks to how quickly I can kill them, this makes for an amazing grinding spot, so I get to it. They can blind me, but it's not a big issue. Now I've got the time. I'd just like to say I never got bored of this overworld theme, Endless Battlefield. It was so catchy. I was interested, so I listened to the versions from the remakes, Sword of Mana and Adventures of Mana, but I actually like this original version most. The other versions were good, especially the Adventures of Mana version, but I just feel like this is one of those tracks that sounds best as the chiptune it was first made as. 28 minutes here and I've doubled my level, going from level 15 to level 30. Look at them stats! Note should be killing me anytime soon. So going back west, I continue north, north again to find another two enemies, the Porcupine and the Mandrake. The hut here is an inn. I cut through the trees here and move west and west again, north and into the shop here. I'm loaded after all that grinding, so I can easily afford to complete the silver set with a silver helmet. It's absolutely worth it, increasing my defense by 5, as if I'm in any danger right now. I go east from the shop, then east again and north to reach the lake Bogard mentioned. I cut down the trees and go east, chain across the river while dealing with the new gas cloud enemy shooting little tornadoes at me, then north and east, chaining up a cliff and going west. I climb down the vine and take the southern west exit so I can chain across to another post and go south. Then west and north two screens to reach the airship. I climb the chain here to get on board. I take the west and north exit and then go west and south, running into a guy who tells me that a girl is being held here. I know. I go through the door and inside, I go through another door to the west. I'm strong enough now that my sword can kill the previously immune slimes. I move west some more to meet my first Eye Spy, looking like Suezo from Monster Rancher. West again takes me to my first ghost, and then north to find some guy telling me to get back to work. I ignore him and go east and down the stairs. West through another door and then south. I press a switch on the east to get rid of the fence to the west, and step on the other switch to create more stairs to go down. I go west into a room with a few spikes on the floor, easily go around them, and go west through the door. I then have to unlock the door to the south to find a cell with Fuji inside. They have to hurry as the airship is preparing to take off. They can't unlock the door, so we're gonna have to find our way around to the outside of the window and get her from there. Bogard also stays behind to keep Fuji safe. Unfortunately, I now have an annoying propeller sound playing over everything that refuses to end. While backtracking, I get hit by an Eye Spy and gain the Moogle status, turning me into a defenseless Moogle. I just realised they weren't in FF4, so this is the first game I've covered on this channel with Moogles. Back of the room with the two switches, I go back north and this time go west and up some stairs. then south into a room where some random dude tells me that the Dark Lord once found a baby in a cave at the Glaive Waterfalls, said baby growing up to be Julius. I go west, west again, west one more time, north, and use a mattock on a vase to reach two more sets of stairs. I go up to end up back outside. From there it's east, north, west, west again, south and east again to reach the ladder down to the windows. East some more and I can see Fuji through one. Rather than escape, she gives Sumo her pendant as Julius shows up demanding it. He knocks Sumo off the edge where he can't hold on, leading to a massive fall. Sumo falls through the roof of the house in the town Menos. One of the people in the house recognises Sumo, and when he wakes up from injury for the fourth time this game, it turns out this is Amanda's house. You know, the woman I spoke to once at the start of the game. I forgot too. She apologises for being unable to stay with Sumo and leaves by the time he can get up. He also doesn't have Fuji's pendant. Going outside, an old man says Amanda left earlier that morning. Another man says he saw a chocobo egg in a forest to the north. With all the money built up from that grind earlier, I can easily afford a wind spear, 2 points stronger than the silver sword. On the east side of town, an old man lets me know that the town Jad is to the north past the desert. A white mage also lets me know that Amanda's little brother, Lester, lives in Jad as a musician. In a house, a woman says that the magic book of ice can be found in the desert. That's all the information I need, so I leave town and then continue south. The spears attack straight forward but can be thrown when charged. I go south again, cross the bridge over the river and go back north, then east. I cross another bridge and then go north. North again and west, along this cliff and then north. North again and very quickly east and south. East once more and chain to a post to reach this egg. As soon as I inspect the egg, a chocobo hatches from it. It imprints on Sumo and starts following him. While backtracking, I reach level 31. I return to the screen with the bridge, free screen south of Menos, and take the west exit to enter the desert. This screen contains my first death scorpions and basilisks. I get petrified here, but it just means I can't walk for a bit, I can still attack in any direction. I go west one screen and already I meet another new enemy, the Saurus. I go north, north again, and west to a screen full of trees, and then go north one more time to reach the town Jad. And it's totally quiet, with no music playing. The first guy I talk to says that this town is ruled by a Devius. In the first house, the woman inside tells me that Devius is the son of a Medusa that lives in a cave hidden in the desert oasis. One boy in town knows how to get in. A dwarf in the east of town lets me know that Devius has a spell to turn people into animals, and that many who've gone to confront him weren't seen again. North of him is the boy who says he'll tell me where the cave of the oasis is if I give him a bag of fangs. These are enemy drops and I don't have any. In the weapon shop, I buy myself a gold shield, gold helmet, and gold armour. Added together, that's 11 more points to defence. In the northwest corner of town is Devius' house. I go through the rooms until I find him and he threatens me. He says he remembers Amanda, saying she went to the cave of Medusa in the oasis. So I leave town and get roaming around, killing enemies to try and get fangs. It takes about 5 minutes to make them drop. On the way back to Jad, I reach level 32. I give them to the kid and he just gives me a clue. Palm trees on 8. I leave town and go south, east, south, south again, west, west again, and north to find another hut. The guy inside sells items that cast spells without using MP. I backtrack 2 screens and go north, east, south, south again, and east to find an inn. From the inn it's west, west again, and north to reach that oasis. I walk around the 2 palm trees in a figure 8 pattern to open the entrance to the cave of Medusa. Despite the head start, Amanda hasn't got very far, she's still in the first room. She admits to taking Fuji's pendant and trying to trade it to Devius for her brother, but he already turned her brother into the parrot that was in his room. Amanda's here to get the tears of Medusa that can cure him, and Sumo agrees to help. I go through the door to the south. Amanda fights by throwing knives in a straight line. I use a mattock to break down the southern wall and get another 2 new enemies at once, the Pakun Lizard and the Mummy, which is unharmed by my weapons. Going west takes me to a room with my first Shadow Zero, which I kill easily enough. I go west again and through the door in the south. Another new enemy, Cobras. West again and one more time, and north through the door. North through the door and north a third time, followed by going west and using a key to unlock the door going south. Killing the enemies in this room spawns a chest with gold armour, so I wasted my money. I go back 2 screens and through the door north into a room with ice, 2 switches and a chain post. Just stepping on them opens the door and I go through to reach a chest containing the magic book of ice. With the ice spell in my possession, I go to the previous room, then all the way south the way I came, reaching level 33 on the way. Backtrack 1 screen east and use a mattock on the northern wall to break through. There's a snowman in this room, a switch and an icy floor. I just have to push the snowman over and onto the switch to open the door north. The next room has 2 tarantulas. I keep messing up killing them. What I have to do is hit one with ice to turn it into another snowman and then push it onto the next switch so I can keep moving north. In the next room I go down the stairs and then north through the door and down more stairs to end up at the bottom. I go west to confront the Medusa. She wanders around the room throwing snakes at me. She can't be damaged from the front, only by hitting her snake hair from the side or from the back. The snakes are nothing, but making physical contact with Medusa herself still causes decent damage even at my level. Just keep stabbing her hair until she explodes. She knows we're here for her tears, so to spite us, she will not cry before her death. Sumo says we should just return to Jad for now, but Amanda stops him. She was bitten by Medusa, and being bitten by Medusa ensures that the victim will also become a Medusa. Amanda begs Sumo to take her tears and kill her before she fully transforms. Sumo says he can't, but her begging and the start of her slow transformation gets through to him, and you, the player, have to deal the killing blow. Sumo takes one of Amanda's tears and we're warped out. I think that may be the oldest case of a game having you perform the killing blow on a dying friend I'm aware of. I haven't seen any that came before this game. The trek back to Jad is uneventful. I return to Devias's room to find that he isn't in, but the parrot I now know to be Lester is, and I use Amanda's tears to cure him. And then after only being able to speak a single sentence, he's informed by Sumo of his sister's death. Lester asks for Sumo's help to avenge his sister and joins up with him. He plays a mystic tune to open up some stairs going down. I go down them to a spiked-filled room and through the door to the east. Two new enemies, Red Wisps and Gargoyles, who pin me against the wall. They're immune to my spear and Lester's bow, but I can't be asked to swap weapons, so I just go east again through another door. Then I use a mattock on the north wall to reach a room filled with candles and go north again. This room introduces magicians, just the standard Final Fantasy Black Mage. They throw massive fireballs, like the ones Julius used as an ally. I unlock the door going west and then south. I have to cross these one-way tiles anti-clockwise along the rooms to reach the stairs going up. Up here it's west, then west again, west yet again into a spiky room where I'm still going west into a room with four switches. I have to start with the eastern one and walk over them anti-clockwise to open up some stairs going down. I go north and west, then south through four screens. In this one I have to freeze an enemy into a snowman and place it on the switch to open the door going east. Killing the enemies in this room gets me a were-axe, 4 points stronger than the wind spear. Backtrack a few screens to this one with a spiked middle and use a mattock on the eastern wall. Then it's south and up some stairs. I unlock the door going north and up more stairs to end up on the roof. I go west to find Devias, who taunts me and transforms into another regular Final Fantasy enemy, the Mind Flayer. This boss is the first to use the game's second, and better, boss theme. He has four fireballs surrounding him and is always firing out more. I just have to get inside his circle, spam my axe and heal when necessary. He goes down in no time. With his dying words, Devias lets us know that he no longer has Fuji's pendant. The Garuda is flying over Mount Rocks to glaive with it. Back outside, Lester uses his harp to get rid of the poisonous gas to the north so that I can continue my quest. It also adds music to Jad. Lester is going to stay here and gives me the magic book of Mute. But that's where we'll be leaving things this episode. I wanted to cover this game in one video, but circumstances have left me with less time, so I'll have to split this one into two. Won't be too long to wait, as the next part will be the first video of the next episode to make up for it. To kick off my 35th, really 45th, set of videos, I'll be finishing off Final Fantasy Adventure. Last time I just freed the town Jad from Devias after being ejected from the Glaive Empire's airship. So now I have to make my way back to Glaive to save Fuji, following a Garuda over Mount Rocks to try and reclaim the Pendant of Mana. So leaving Jad, my next destination is Glaive. I could ride the Chocobo to speed things up, but you can't fight on it and so I'd miss out on experience. From the entrance to Jad I go south, east, north, east, north and meet another two new enemies at once, the Ape and Mole Bear. North again and this group of werewolves get me to level 34. I get the grinding bug again since they're all huddled in one spot and over 6 minutes grind myself 2 levels to level 36. I then cut through the trees and go east, facing my first goldfish enemy and then north. North again up the stairs to reach Mount Rocks and east across the bridge and north up even more stairs, then west and into the cave entrance to the cave of Mount Rocks. I go west, cut through some coral, I think, and meet the Phantasm, another enemy immune to my weapons. I go north and west, cutting through a room filled with coral, I think, and then through the western door. I then go south and west one more time to meet the boss of this place already, the Metal Crab. This one fights by shuffling around the screen, taking up most of the space and colliding with me. The opposite of the Medusa, this one I can only damage by attacking its front. That's all there is to say about this fight, and as long as you keep your health topped up, it shouldn't be long before it's defeated. It leads behind some stairs to the next floor. I go west, west again, west a third time, and up the stairs in the corner to end up back outside. From here I move west, south, east, south again, south through the next two screens, and south once more for another two enemies, always appearing in pairs I've noticed, this time the Ogre and the Barnacle Jack. To the east is a recovery spring, then going back I take the east and north exit, then east again and north of the stairs and east again. There are two vines here and I climb the eastern one up two screens to reach a hut. It's an armory where I can buy myself some expensive opal armor, opal helmet and opal shield. Putting them all on is an extra 8 defense. I climb back down and take the western vine up 3 screens where I next have to go west so I can cut around the trees to go back east on the northern half and then take the northern exit. North through one more screen and the enemies on this one get me to level 37. From here it's east and south, cut through the trees and south again, east and north up the stairs and go through the entrance to enter Mount Rocks proper. To start with I can move in 3 directions, but I go north, then east and east again to what looks like a dead end. I use a mattock on the northern wall to break through to another room and then go west into a room with 4 switches and 4 empty chests. Got to be careful killing the wolves or you could end up destroying the chests and have to leave the room and try again. I place all the chests on the switches but nothing happens, so I just have to destroy one of them after it to open the door going north. I then go east and unlock another door to keep going east, cut through the coral I think and east some more, then I get going south. South again, south a third time, then east, across a bridge and east again and up the stairs in the room at the end. This takes me outside where I go east once more to reach the boss of this place, the Cyclops. It moves around swinging a morning star above its head, swinging out in front of itself. This guy moves quickly so I find the easiest way to deal with him is to stay away, watch my attack charge up and when fully charged I throw my axe at him. It takes a while thanks to all that time charging, but it works and I take him down. I then take his morning star as a weapon. I'm very thankful for this weapon as it can break down walls. This means I never have to rely on mattocks again. I have held a grudge against them ever since the situation at Ketz. It's also 10 attack points stronger than the Wereaxe. I go back inside, backtrack west 2 screens and then keep going west, taking me back to the start of this place, then north again. I learn that the Morningstar can actually kill the phantasms I've been ignoring. I unlock the door to the north and go through to reach a second boss, the Grinder. It zips around the screen with constant shoulder charges, but all that does is allow me to spam my Morningstar and let it run right into it. It's taken out in no time and leaves the Magic Book of Lightning. I go north through the next door, break through the rocks without needing a mattock, and go up the stairs to end up back outside. I cross the bridge here to the east and go back inside, the bridge collapsing behind me first to make sure I can't go back. We are now back at Glaive, outside the waterfall where I first saw the Dark Lord and Julius. I walk 2 screens east and enter Glaive Castle through the front door. The next gate is closed so I have to go west and cut through the trees so I can go west again, then north around the castle walls to reach a door and get inside. We're in the waterway now and I start by crossing both bridges and going north, crossing another bridge and going east. I cross the next bridge and go east, cross the next one going north and keep moving east, then cross another to go up some stairs. Back outside I climb this vine all the way north to the top of this tower and go down the stairs back inside. Then down another set of stairs to end up back outside. I go down the steps and then west where on this screen is another boss already, the Chimera. It spits 2 fireballs straight down from its wings and charges across the screen in a zigzag pattern. This means I just hang out close to it spamming the Morningstar, letting it run into me and healing when needed, just like how I dealt with the Grinder. It's defeated just as easily. I go down the stairs here and back inside to reunite with Fuji. Sumo lets her know that they have her pendant and she joins back up with me, saying that the Dark Lord's room is on the top floor. I go down the stairs and in the next room, go up the stairs in the northeast corner. I go down the steps here which have me separated from my first opponents with another 2 new enemies, the Darkstalker and the Wizard. Basically repurposed Dark Knight and Mega sprites from Final Fantasy III. The wizards are still a threat as they can petrify me from a distance. I go west and through the door where a guy inside will sell me items. I go back 3 screens up those steps where I reach level 38 and then go west. They're really filling the screen with strong enemies now. I keep going west, west again, and then south to reach another door back inside. Have to walk over spikes in here, there's no choice. I lock the door going north and in the north room go east and in the next screen I break down the northern wall. This room is filled with damaging sparks I have to navigate around so I can go east to a room filled with pits that I have to use my chain to cross using the posts. I reach a switch at the other end to open some stairs in the corner. Down the stairs I go north, east, south, south again, east, unlock the eastern door and find a bed I can rest in for free. I backtrack 2 screens west and go west again and down the stairs in this room. Or I could if I could not destroy the chest on the switches keeping it there, but I reach level 39 which makes up for it. I eventually get down the stairs and then go east, east again, smash through the eastern wall, go east once again, then north through the door and up the stairs. I go south and east through the door to a room filled with enemies, killing them all spawns a chest containing the blood sword. It's 4 points weaker than the Morningstar, but heals me when I damage an enemy. Back west and north, I break down the northern wall and unlock the door to the east. I then go up the stairs and on the next floor, go through the doors to the south and to the west. Then west again where there are two switches. I have to use ice to create two snowmen and place them on the switches. I keep messing up though, either killing enemies or destroying snowmen. And during one of my attempts to leave the room to respawn the enemies, I reach level 40. But I eventually get it and go down the new stairs. I go west and then north to another set of stairs to go up, then through the door to the north which leads into the Dark Lord's throne room. He's not in, so I go west and then up some stairs to find him at the top of the castle. He can tell Sumo has gotten stronger, but doesn't feel very threatened. Sumo tells Fuji to keep back and the battle starts. The Dark Lord cannot be harmed from the front on his shield side, but he's a total pushover. He just wanders around and thanks to me having the blood sword, I can just stay inside him pounding away recovering my health. Throw in a few charged shots as well and he's finished quickly. He doesn't even explode like the others. Sumo recovers Fuji's pendant, but it turns out to be a fake. I go back down to the previous room to find that Fuji is missing again. Sumo also realises that he hasn't seen Julius here either, and realises he must have taken Fuji to the waterfalls. We warp outside where we can see Fuji slowly walking to the west, not responding to Sumo's calls. I follow her to the waterfalls where once again she ignores Sumo. Julius then reveals himself. He has Fuji under mind control, and he has the real pendant. He commands her to use a spell on the waterfalls. Julius reveals that he is the last survivor of the Vandal Empire who used mana to conquer the world, and he plans to take that power back. Fuji reverses the waterfalls, and her and Julius go up them, preventing Sumo from following by blasting him off into the distance. Sumo is too injured to move, but his chocobo turns up to carry him off, taking him east into the town-ish. We don't see it, but both Sumo and the chocobo collapse in town and are found by a woman, Sarah. Sumo wakes up in Sarah's house with Bogard in the next bed. When Julius caught us on the airship, Bogard was thrown overboard and found by Sarah. Sumo's a bad loser and throws a temper tantrum. Having been beaten up so many times, he thinks he's the wrong person to become a new Gemma Knight. Bogard tries to calm him down, but Sumo isn't having any of it and tells the greatly injured bedridden old man to do it himself. Bogard rightly tells him to shut the fuck up and get out. As soon as he gets outside, Sarah tells Sumo that Bogard broke his back and isn't going to be moving for a while. Through all the stories of places being attacked by the Empire, he kept telling people it will be alright because a boy called Sumo will save everyone, and after seeing him turn up, everyone in town believes in him now. She also lets him know that the Chocobo is being treated by a Dr. Bowow. Going back inside, you can't apologise, as Bogard won't even talk to Sumo. And it's deserved. One thing that's always drove me up the wall, especially going back 15 or so years to the peak of emo being the then current word of choice for character I don't like, is people taking one scene of a character reacting under great duress or having suffered personal tragedy and using it to just write off characters as whiny. RPG characters in general especially suffered this from late 2000s nerds trying their best to make themselves look smarter than the game. And majority of the time I found those people's reactions overblown or desperate. But this is one of those few times where I actually do find the character's breakdown unsympathetic. I really shouldn't, but I think it might be the English localization script. Obviously the game is intending for Sumo to be in the wrong since it immediately has Sarah pile on the massive guilt trip. It's as I described it just a bit earlier. The dialogue makes it feel less like having reached his emotional limit after several losses, but more like a kid shouting and screaming because he's lost to the video game boss 4 times now. It's not character ruining or anything since it's just one scene, but it was what I was thinking while I was playing. Next door to Sarah is the armory. I buy myself some flame armor, a flame shield, and a flame flail. For all the money, the armor just gets me 2 more defense. And then I realize I like my bloodsword too much at the moment to want to swap it out. Going to the west, and the way they had to shrink the game's script down to fit in the cartridge does lead to some amusing ways explaining things. Like this guy, who says that the Vandal Empire used to prosper around here, but they were defeated by Gemma Knight with some sword. Just some sword. Who cares? On the western end of town is Dr. Bauau's house. I can hear banging inside, and when I go in, I learn that he's mechanised my chocobo's wounded legs, turning him into a hovercraft that can run on water. Well, those legs better have been injured beyond repair, or else he's just mutilated my newborn chocobo for a laugh. He also tells me to talk to Bogard again before I leave town. Bogard's talking to Sumo again and tells him things are going to be more dangerous from now. Julius has the power of mana, so the only way to counter him is with the legendary sword Excalibur, the same sword that was used to defeat the Vandal Empire. Sumo asks where the sword is. Bogard's response, somewhere in the world. Yeah, thanks. He tells me to go to Wendell and ask Kibber about it, and to also ask Dr. Bowow for directions back there from Ish. Bowow tells me to go east from the pier to the north, then north will take me to Wendell, with south being the way to the Ammonites. On my way out of town, one girl tells me about the Dime Tower, built by Vandor that sank beneath the desert. As I leave town, I learn that all new areas in the overworld I discover have a second overworld theme. I love when games do that, change their overworld or world map theme when things get serious. West into the screen, Sumo was blasted to for two more enemies, the Dragonfly and the Megazorn. I go west once again, and then north for another new enemy, the Bullet. North again to reach the sea, and then west once more to reach that pier. I can now get on the Chocobot and get onto the sea, if I was already on him. But I annoyingly left him outside of Ish, so I walk back, talk to him to have him join me, get on him, and ride him back to the pier and onto the sea. I go east 7 screens, passing a snowy mountain, then north 2 screens to reach another pier. Then going north a couple more and back on land takes me back to Wendell. Talking to one of the girls has me learn that the town Lorim was attacked by monsters and Kibba left to help them out. Help the town, not the monsters. She says Lorim is to the south, past the snowfield. So it's back to that pier and south and then west along the mountain I pass until I reach the screen with a hut on it. Then I follow the sea south, east and south 4 more screens to reach another pier to get back on land with. I go north up the steps, east, south 2 screens, east and north up more stairs to reach the town Lorim. The first person I speak to here is Frozen. In the northern door is the throne room, where the king tells me that a monster called Kari, Square's old localization of Marilith, is the cause behind the freezing. Kibba is also here, but he's stuck in the other room. Time to leave already and get this sorted. I return to the pier and go north of the sea all the way until I leave this valley, then get running east until I reach the screen south of the Wendell Pier. I take the fork east, then south 3 screens, then east and south 4 more screens, then west into this river, follow it north 2 screens, west, south and back on land from the pier there. I go north, the Chocobot letting me ignore these new Manta Ray and Griffinhand enemies and go east, south, east and north. There's a chain post, so I have to get off the Chocobot and put myself at the mercy of these sea dragons so I can chain across and keep going north. North again, then west where I reach level 41. North, west, chain across the sea to go north where there's an armory on this screen. I get myself the new ice armor and ice shield which together get me 8 more defense. Now for a lot of backtracking. Back to the pier that leads to Lorim, on the screen to the north I cut down the trees and keep going north. North again, across a bridge and north once more where Sumo tells the Chocobot to stay back as it's too cold for him. More new enemies, first the snowman, then to the north are the walrus and sabercat. I go east, east again and south again and west, south and east again to reach the entrance to the Cave of Snowfields. First screen has another new enemy, the Poto. I go north for 2 more, the Air Element and Beholder. Of these 3, only the Beholder can be damaged by my sword. I go north again to a room with a snowman and a switch. I stand on the switch to make the snowman slide off the ice and then push it onto the switch to open the door to go east. I chain across the water and go north, then chain across the ice tiles to fight my first duck soldier and go west. I unlock the door to the north and find that the flame flail I bought can kill the Potos easily. I go through the east door and do it again on the next screen. Then through the north door and up the stairs. I go north, west and ride the ice north into the next room, then walk around the northernmost ice and ride that west through 2 screens, then in the next room ride the western ice south through 2 screens. Killing an air element with the flame flail gets me to level 42. I get on the southern row of ice and ride it east, south and east. I then get in the middle row of ice, riding it west and then north to get off in this room. Then break down the northern wall between these plants to find some stairs. Up those stairs I break down the northern wall again to reach a recovery spring. Back out and I take the western door, then go south and kill the enemies to spawn a chest with an elixir. Backtrack 2 rooms and I take the eastern door. Then the northern door and go up the stairs to find a unique looking area, where I go east and through the door at the end. I next chain across some ice and take the western door, cross a bridge and keep going west, then south to find a room with a circle of ice and 2 switches. Stepping on the switch in the middle gets rid of 2 ice tiles so that I can reach the other switch that opens the door going south. Then through the door to the east, cut through the coral I think and go east some more. Then I take this bottom row of ice on the east to go east 2 more screens. In this room I take the eastern ice south and then do so again on the next screen, then chain across the ice and take the bottom row of ice west. Through the northern door here is another recovery spring and then I go back and take another southern row of ice tiles west, chaining onto a post to get off the ice. After a few minutes of failed attempts that is. I then break through the western wall and chain across to a few posts to reach some stairs. This takes me outside, high up the mountains where I go east and back into the cave. I chain across some more posts and go east, north through the door and chain across to more stairs. This takes me outside again where I go east to finally meet this Kari, or Marilith. She throws icicles towards me and charges forward with her tail with her head as her weak spot. Just stay above her as long as possible and you have access to her head and will avoid most of her attacks. She's weak to the flame flail, so it doesn't take long to kill her. She also leaves behind a chest containing the ice sword. Walk back outside, I head on back to Lorim, reaching level 43 on the way. Back inside, everyone is unfrozen. I go east and north through the door to find Kibber. He gives me the bone key and tells me to go up the wide river by the Ammonite coast, and then past it to the float rocks and use the key inside the cave there. He says that the guardian monster there has Excalibur, then he'll tell me the rest when I return with it. So out of Lorim and from the screen that leads down the river towards it, I go north, west 3 screens, north 2 screens, and get off at the pier there. Getting between the palm trees, I follow the path west, south, west again, south again, west, and north to reach the cave of Palmy Desert. I was skipping ahead a bit here, but this place is very short and I was wanting to wrap up that recording session. I go down the stairs and the second room has more new enemies for me, the Fire Moth and Earth Element. My new ice sword destroys them. I go down more stairs and in the next room go north to already find the boss of this place, Lich. He flies around the screen throwing skulls at me. It seems he's also weak to the Flame Flail, but I prefer the Blood Sword here as making contact with him deals a lot of damage and I want my healing to outpace his damage. Even then, there are still times when the Blood Sword isn't enough and I have to use Cure. He doesn't take long to defeat though, and he drops the Magic Book of Nuke, granting me the game's best offensive spell. It's so funny to me, all the stuff that wasn't allowed past Nintendo of America's censors back in the day, and yet naming a magic spell Nuke was perfectly fine in this game and the US SNES Final Fantasy IV, not 2. From the pier, I go south 2 screens, west 5 screens, north 2 screens, west 2 screens, north 6 screens, and back through the river I passed earlier when buying the ice equipment. I get off at the pier, go north and east, but this time I change to this post here and go south, south again, east, south 3 screens, and west. Another new enemy, the Tortoise Knight, immune to the flail, so I break through the rocks with the Morning Star and take it down with that. I go south, south again, east and south, and then go west and north across the bridge and south again. South once more where I reach level 44 from a Tortoise Knight, then west to another hut. In here I can buy the Thunder Spear for over 11,000 GP. This is gonna be useful soon. From the hut I go south, east, south, east, break the rocks and keep moving east, break more and go north to find another hut. It doesn't sell anything I need and I go west to find a locked door. I use the bone key to enter the cave of float rocks. I go north and north again through the door, then break through the eastern wall and keep going east. I break the rocks here to stand on a switch to create a path to the door, then clear the way to the second switch to open it so I can continue east. I go through the door to the north, north again, then break through the northern wall to reach some stairs. It leads to this bridge where I go east to take on another boss, the Kraken. Tiamat was the only one left out. It hangs out below the bridge, poking me with its tentacles while I just stand above, stabbing it with the Thunder Spear and healing when necessary. It doesn't take long at all to defeat, and its death opens up a door I can go through. This places me back on the overworld where I go east, south, west and north to reach another door back inside. To start with, I go south, west, west again, through the door to the north and then break down the western wall. I have to place 2 snowmen on both the switches, but first I have to cut away the plants without killing the enemies I'll be using for this. While moving back a few screens to respawn them, I reach level 45. I get both switches on my 4th attempt to open up some stairs in the corner. It leads outside where I go west and through a door back inside. I go west to find a room where the door to the north is blocked off by lava. Since I have the health, I can run through the lava to the door without getting killed. In the next room I go north again, then west, south, down the stairs and west, break through the rocks and go south. I then have to walk through lava to reach the door going south, which I have to use a key on. Killing all the duck soldiers in here spawns a chest with a Zeus axe inside. I backtrack 5 rooms and go through the northern door. I then break down the eastern wall and go down the stairs. It takes me outside again where I go through the other door back inside. I go north, through the eastern door where I reach level 46, keep moving east, then south through the door and south again to find the recovery spring. Back to the last room and unlock the door going east, then break the southeastern rock to find some stairs. It leads to 3 doors and I take the eastern one. From here I go south, west through the door, north and in this room freeze 2 snowmen to place on the switches to create some stairs to go down. From this screen I go west to face the boss of this place, Ifrit, or Ifleet as this version calls it. His only attack is to curl up into a fireball and roll around the screen. After that he'll waddle side to side a bit before starting again. In ball form I can hit him from the sides, and when uncurled he only takes damage to the face. He takes a bit longer than the Kraken, but he still isn't very hard so long as you just keep healing. The chest he leaves behind contains a rusty sword, confusing Sumo. Booted back outside, it's time to return to Lorim. I actually get my first and only death here as I get moogled and a griffin hand launches itself into me just before it wears off, dealing insane damage. Back at Lorim, I talk to Kibber again. He He says the only thing left to do is to reveal the Dime Tower, the one that sunk under the Desert of Crystal. He tells me that the Rusty Sword will help me if I use it in the Cave of Ruins. Excalibur will only show its true form if it approves of the wielder. He tells me the cave is in the desert near Ish and to ask Dr. Bowow for more information. So, time to trek back to Ish. Not long after I leave Lorien, I reach level 47. The journey back there is quick and I go straight for Bowow's house. He tells me that there's a piece of crystal in the desert I can destroy with the nuke spell, but he doesn't tell me which one. From Ish, I get using Nuke on the Crystals. It turns out to be on the screen 2 west and 2 north from Ish. The one on the right leaves behind a hole I can enter to find the Cave of Ruins. I start this place by going west and meeting 2 new enemies at once, the Denden and the Doppelmirror. I go west again and down the stairs, then through the door to the north. This room introduces the Guardians. Plus there's these tiles on the ground that will only let you pass through a certain direction. I get through to the eastern door to find a chest containing the Dragon Shield. I go back to the last room and take the northern door, then go north again, through the western door, navigate the sparks and go west again to reach a chest containing the Dragon Sword, 10 points stronger than the Thunder Spear. I go back 2 rooms and go east through the door and east again, north through the door and north again, north through another door, then around the spikes and west. North once more to reach the boss, the Mantis Ant. This surprised me, since I have played Secret of Mana, I recognise this as the first boss in that game, so seeing it being such a late game boss here was a bit odd. First I have to walk through the sparks and take damage to reach it, which is a bit of a dick move. Apart from that, it just moves around swinging its scythe hands. Like the last few, I let it come to me while swinging away and healing whatever damage it deals to me. Simple. Its death opens up a door to the east. I go through and stand on the switch with the Rusty Sword equipped. I'm sent outside and told the Dime Tower will rise somewhere in the desert. Well, it can wait. I travel to around the lake where the airship was and return to this screen with the 4 werewolves in a line for a little grind. Using my flame flail to kill them all in moments after entering the screen and repeating. And by little grind, I mean just over 5.5 hours, about a third or 2/5 of my total time spent playing this game. I grinded all the way to level 99, getting myself a full 99 on all stats, HP maxed at 999. MP I could only get 1 point short at 98 though. I also maxed out my money at 65,535 GP. It needed to be done at some point and looking at how much of the game was left, this would have been the last chance. Now to look for that tower. Starting from the screen with the Cave of Ruins, I go 2 screens south, 1 east, 1 south, and 1 west. Once I enter this screen, I see the Dime Tower rise from the sand. I go inside and in the first room, this robot introduces itself as Marcy to me. It was built by Dr. Bowow to search the tower for relics. It was left here by him and forgotten 50 years ago, while the tower sank beneath the sand. It then offers to help me out. To start with, I go west and then north to find 2 more new enemies, the Wonder and the Garasha. Marcy fights by firing lasers in a straight line. I go north again for another 2 new enemies, the Death Gauntlet and Evil Sword. This time I go east, then break down the eastern wall. I go north through the door and in the next room go west and then up the stairs. I go west again and notice I can't help but spend time trying to kill enemies I don't need to since I can't get anything more out of them. I go south, east, south, south again. In this room is a stone tablet saying that whoever touches the mana tree gains its power. I go east and up some stairs, taking me outside where I climb north up this vine. At the top, I then go through a door back inside and then west, unlock the northern door, through the eastern door, and then find a chest containing dragon armour, a nice 6-point increase over the ice armour. I backtrack west and then break down the western wall to go up the stairs in the next screen. Going south from here will take me to a room where I can rest for free, and then go back and up the next set of stairs. 2 switches in here with Minotaur stood on them surrounded by trees. I have to carefully cut down the trees without killing them and use the ice spell to turn them into snowmen to activate the switches. Thing is, Marcy's laser can kill them and it likes to just get in there and wipe them out while I'm trying to sort out the puzzle. It takes me about 12 or 13 attempts before it goes well and the door to the north is opened. Going east then takes me to another tablet saying that the Vandal Empire should fall soon and that they leave their last hope in the Cave of Waterfalls. It turns out to be a message written by one from the Empire to Julius. I go south and then up some more stairs. Back outside, I go north up more stairs to the top of the tower to reach the boss, Garuda. I was told this flew the pendant from Jad to Glaive, but I never ran into it until now. It'll throw a couple feathers at me, then swoop diagonally across the screen and then repeat. With my maxed out stats, I'm under no threat and it dies in no time. Marcy says the tower is losing balance and that they have to hurry. I run west, across a bridge to reach land, but the bridge collapses at the end. Marcy says it will throw Sumo and then jump after him. Once Sumo is over, Marcy reveals that it can't jump and was lying. It was made to work in this tower and goes down with it. It knew that Suma would stay behind to try and save it, getting himself killed as well. The tower had managed to stretch all the way back to Glaive Castle, so all I have to do is return to the waterfalls. With no one to send me falling down a third time, I can finally ride them up. I go shooting all the way to the top, and from there I go west and north to reach the Temple of Mana. To start with, I go south and find another Final Fantasy III sprite turn into an enemy, this time the ninja. I go east, east again, and north. In this room, I kill a ninja that drops a chest containing the strongest armor in the game, the Samurai Armor, 10 points stronger than the Dragon Armor. I go north again, and then unlock the northern door and up the stairs. I go up more stairs on this screen, and I'm already facing another boss, the dragon. He just walks around the screen spitting fireballs while taking damage only from the head. It's an easy fight, and it can only do one damage at a time to me, but I should have swapped to a weapon with more range to make hitting the head easier. Once it's done, it leaves behind a teleporter I take. On this next screen, I go west to find the new demon enemy. These should only be killed by the nuke spell, but at my level, a fully charged dragon sword attack is good enough. I get on another teleporter, and in the next room, go west. I go north and west, but then find I need a key to continue, and I've run out, and I can't go back. So I run back to some of the first rooms as they placed early enemies here that drop keys. I return to that door and unlock it, then take the teleporter. I go east and take another teleporter, then go through the door to the south. I break down the western wall and go west again. In this room, one of the demons I kill drops a chest containing the Samurai Helmet, the best helmet in the game, 6 points stronger than the Opal Helmet. I then go south and through the western door to another teleporter. From it I go west, south, south again, and into a room filled with blocks, a locked door, a switch, and two Minotaurs. This is the first time where the fact I can control the movement of the ice spell is relevant. I just have to navigate through this maze and hit the Minotaur on the switch to open the door. Through that door I go up some stairs, then north up more steps to face another boss, the Red Dragon. Trust me, it's red. It's also an exact repeat of the previous dragon boss, so there isn't anything to say other than I kill it. Through the teleporter and then west on the next screen to another one. Back inside, I go north, east, north through the door and onto another teleporter. East on this screen to another teleporter back inside. I go south, east and east through the door to yet another teleporter. I unlock the door to the west to find a recovery spring and go back through the teleporter, back west a room and then south to another teleporter. Another outdoor screen again where I go west to another teleporter. Then east through the door and east again, east a third time, east a fourth time, east a fifth time into a room with a ninja and a load of switches. I have to freeze the ninja and place it on the correct switch, which is the one two south from the western entrance. I then go north, north again, north a third time, and up the stairs. This takes me to another boss arena. But this one isn't a repeat, it's a zombie dragon. This one is actually easier. It just moves around and shoots fireballs, but since it has two heads for weak points, I have an easier time dealing damage faster. It goes down in no time. Through the teleporter to the last stretch. From here I just have to keep walking north, but first we have the Mammoth, the final enemy in the game. I keep killing them until one drops a chest containing the Aegis Shield. That's the game's strongest shield, and me as best defended as I can possibly be. After moving a few screens north across this bridge, I enter a forest. I go north again and find Fuji's mother waiting for me. She recognises Sumo as a true Gemma Knight and grants him the Excalibur. A massive 29 points stronger than the Dragon Sword, I'm now as powerful as you can possibly be in this game. I go north through two more screens and then west, south, west around more trees, and north up one more set of stairs to find a mana tree, where Julius and Fuji are waiting. Julius says Sumo is too late, as he has already gained the power of mana from the tree, which he plans to use to build his Neo Vandal Empire. He says he doesn't need Sumo anymore, and we can now finally fight him. Julius splits himself into three copies, all throwing out endless fireballs. This is over in no time. He can barely harm me, and my huge strength stat takes out all three of them easily. He's far from done, and unleashes the power he gained from the tree, transforming into this thing that has a second head where his dick should be. He moves around shooting lightning from each of his shoulders, and occasionally going in for a forward charge. Once again, my defense is so high, he only manages to deal 12 damage to me before I kick his head in again. I'm returned to the mana tree where Fuji is broken from a hypnotism. Sumo reassures her that it's all over, but Julius chimes in to say that it is in fact not. Julius takes on one more form and I have to fight him in front of the mana tree, with Fuji walking around to help if I need her. This form is a slightly bigger threat. He can do around 30 damage to me on contact. He teleports around the screen throwing fireballs from both of his hands before teleporting again. I just have to get the hits in before he disappears again. Fuji isn't much healthier, it's far more convenient to just cast Cure myself and heal for more than it is to go into the menu and ask her for her weaker Cure. It's not long though until I smack him enough and make him explode like the rest of them. However, in his death, the mana tree is also destroyed. The two have no idea what to do, but Fuji's mother appears. With the mana tree gone, they need a new tree. She reminds Fuji that they are the seeds of the mana tree. Fuji has to transform into a bud called a Gemma, and then she must grow into the new mana tree herself. The Gemma Knights then have to fight to protect the tree. Fuji's mother was the tree that was just lost, and Fuji is the last member of the mana family. While her mother says no one can decide this for Fuji, it's pretty clear she has no choice but to become the next mana tree. Fuji does agree to it with no argument though. She's also aware that if she is the last, then when the tree that she becomes dies, then that's it, the world is in for a bad time. This also leaves Sumo as the only remaining Gemma Knight to watch over her, Fuji's mother asking him to give her thanks to her surviving knights. She begins to wither and Fuji takes her place while her and Sumo say their goodbyes. Over the credits we get to see some extra bits with no dialogue, Sumo returning to Ish to see Bogard and Sarah, riding minecarts with Watts, seeing Kibber, watching Lester play his harp and returning the chocobo to his family. We then end on an image of Fuji beginning to sprout as the new mana tree. I think this is the earliest RPG I've played to have a total downer ending like this. You saved the world, for a bit, but it cost the lives of a few friends, ensured the end of a species, and things will go to shit eventually. I like this game. It's been a while since I played a top-down action RPG like this, the closest comparison being Crystalis, although I still like Crystalis more. It had a slightly irritating beginning with the whole Matok situation, but it soon picked up. Although I must say that my enjoyment was helped by me using a guide. The dungeons all had several dead ends that I was able to avoid and save a lot of time from just knowing not to take those routes. I was impressed by the amount of story they managed to squeeze into a game relatively early on in the Game Boy's life, along with all those temporary allies you get to hang out with. And a great soundtrack, although I think it'd be more noteworthy to have a Final Fantasy without one of those. The collection I have this game on also includes Secrets of Mana and Trials of Mana, so the option to cover those two in the future is always there. Though I would also like to cover this game's two remakes, Sword of Mana on the GBA and Adventures of Mana on the Vita, but the former is expensive and I don't have the Vita for the latter, so they'd have to wait. Hopefully one day.